Welcome to the Virtual Office Hours, Public Scholar Edition. My name is John Fee. I teach American History here at Messiah College. Our trusted producer, Megan Piette, is behind the camera. Megan's doing also a great job on our new feature, the Author's Corner. We have some really good interviews lined up. So if you've been following the blog, check out the Author's Corner. We have Randall Balmer, Thomas Slaughter is coming up, and a few other interesting books. So stay tuned on that. We're excited about this new initiative at the blog, and it seems like you are too, since those posts are getting a lot of hits. But again, we're talking about how to be a public scholar. We've looked at things like writing op-eds and blogging and public speaking, social media, all of these kinds of things. Today I want to talk a little bit about writing books for popular audiences. Now, if you're a historian, I think there are, there's probably more than three, but let me just throw out three kind of models of the kinds of books that a historian could write. One is the sort of traditional academic monograph. This is usually, something on a very particular topic. It's scholarly in nature. Many monographs are dissertations that get turned into a book. So that's one. I mean, an academic monograph is really going to be targeted towards other academics. Then I think there is the kind of academic history or even scholarly history that might have what publishers call crossover appeal. In other words, it's an academic book or a scholarly book, but it's written in such an accessible way, or the topic is so interesting that it has appeal to both popular and academic audiences. So, I'm thinking about academics who write these kinds of books, like Jill Lepore, for example, comes to mind, especially her recent stuff on Jane Franklin. Or John Furling, for example, writes, he has an academic appointment, and he writes about the American Revolution, or, the kind of academics that write in trade presses. They're academic books, but they have kind of crossover appeal. And then finally, I think there's books that just are written directly with popular audiences in mind. And I don't even think you have to hold an academic appointment or have a PhD to write those kinds of books. So when you're thinking about writing books for popular audiences, or how to go about doing it, let me just suggest three things to think about, maybe four things to think about. First, if you are an academic historian, consider your academic location. What kind of institution do you teach at? Many institutions require an academic monograph for tenure. So there, the ideal is, you're writing a book to prove that you can, do history, you can write do scholarship. I often recommend for younger scholars going into the field to publish your dissertation as an academic monograph. Don't necessarily worry as much about its public appeal unless it, maybe has a crossover appeal and you want to push that. But the academic monograph, of course, is going to establish you as a legitimate professional historian. Many times you're just writing this for job security, so you can get tenure and then, don't have to worry about things as you move on with the rest of your career. Another thing to think about, who is, when you write, what is your audience? Again, I often encourage people to not start writing, academics at least, not to start writing for public audiences until they have written a monograph. But, consider your audiences. My first book, The Way of Improvement Leads Home, was really an academic monograph with some limited crossover appeal. And then when I wrote Was America Founded as a Christian Nation, I really targeted that towards a popular audience. My audience was people, mostly religious people, Christian people, who were sort of confused or needed some guidance on this topic. That's also going to influence the type of publisher that you choose. I could have published Was America Founded as a Christian Nation with some academic or university presses. They were interested in it. But I realized that most of the people that I wanted to reach with the book don't read books from university presses. They rather read books from more popular presses. And I chose a religious press in this case because I thought that would be the best way to get my message out to the kind of audience I wanted to reach. So consider your audience when you're doing this, and as a result, then consider what kind of publisher you want to go with. Many people who write for popular books actually have literary agents. You can't publish a book with some of the larger trade presses without having an agent. They will not take unsolicited manuscripts from you, so it might be worthwhile to find a literary agent. Best way to do that is to go online or go to Barnes & Noble and get one of those big literary marketplace books. Find an agent that works in ask your friends who have agents, what these agents are. A lot of agents work in particular subfields and so forth. You don't necessarily have to have an agent to reach a public audience, but it certainly helps if you do that. And of course, then the agent gets a percentage of your royalties on the book. This plays off, I think, what we talked a little bit about last time when we were talking about public speaking. If you write a book for a popular audience, it's going to be very translatable into public speaking opportunities and engagement with the public. The more accessible the book is, the more you will have opportunities to promote the book, both in bookstores and other public venues, on radio, maybe even on television, and those kinds of things. If you're interested in writing for popular audiences, I think these are some of the things that you may want to consider as you do so. So once again, thanks for watching The Office Hours, and we will be back next week.